good morning and welcome to St. John's on Easter Sunday. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Those are the ancient words that have been said. And here we are in our sanctuary with our Paschal candle. And we have our resurrection shroud, which is all very nice. And I thank the team for putting that together. On a regular Easter Sunday, I would be in procession coming in from the back. And it's always my privilege at Christmas and at Easter to read the sentences, to have them fill the building with these ancient words. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with the old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. And Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once. But in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And Christ is risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. I ask you to find some quiet at home, and bow your head, and let these words wash over you. Lord of life and power, through the mighty resurrection of your Son, you have overcome the old order of sin and death and have made all things new in him. May we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, reign with him in glory, who with you and the Holy Spirit is alive, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to St. John's.
And thank you for joining us on this glorious Easter Sunday.
We want to send a quick shout out to our beloved band. We actually have one member who's fighting on the front lines, and we have others who are in isolation.
Yeah. Carol, thank you so much for all that you do. We just want you to know that we are praying for you all the time. And guys, we're missing you up here.
But we've also made a conscious decision, obviously for safety reasons, to continue on with just the two of us.
Still, it's a privilege during these difficult times to be able to gather virtually and share the joy of the risen Christ.
So we hope you'll sing with us from the safety of wherever you are as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Here we go.
Yeah. earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name up.
Be with you and with thy spirit. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Saint Matthew. Glory be to thee, O Lord. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descending from heaven came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples. He has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." The Gospel of Christ. Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, and he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." So Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. I hope you're coping with the virus, this pandemic. I hope you're holding up. I think especially of those who have to work at home. Not everybody has a great spacious home. Some live in rather small apartments, and I don't know about your circumstances, but I have felt for those who feel confined, especially with little children and big children around. These times may be difficult. And so above all, I hope your spirit has not been diminished, that you are finding some purpose in all of this isolation that we are experiencing. On the lighter side, I've learned a few things from listening to people who have been dealing with their spouses and their children and trying to learn from one another. And as you know, in my sermons, I often like to do something a little bit lighter. I heard someone say, "You know, relationships are a lot like algebra." How's that? Have you ever looked at your ex and wondered why? I don't know. You working with me here, folks? I think my neighbor is stalking me, she said. I think she's Googling my name on the computer. And I said, well, how do you know that? She says, I saw her doing it through my binoculars. I don't know. Pretty bad? Last one, folks, work with me. This one is profound. It is from a child. And children can learn stuff. And this was her wisdom. She said, what I have learned in all of this is, don't let mommy brush your hair after she's had an argument with daddy. Da-dump. I think that kind of says it all. People are living in very difficult times. But I can still say happy Easter to one and all. This is to be the high point of our Christian life. It's the high of the Christian year. As much as we love our Christmas, we are primarily called an Easter people. Every Sunday is a variation of Easter. Every Sunday is a resurrection day. And it is why we're called to give thanks, to celebrate, to sing, to worship. I confess once again how difficult it is for us to worship this way, that we're not really together, that there is no choir behind me. Where's Patrick? Or Moni and Rob, you know, the band and lifting our spirits. I miss them. And I want you to know that you can find them on the website. And I really want to do a shout out to Patrick, who has done this extra special piece of Monday music and meditations. And the Banditos, you know, you really lift our spirits. And I'm thankful for that. And I also want to give thanks to Jillian, who's always seeming behind the camera, editing all this and putting it together. Our Easter celebration would not happen without you. To Bill and Mark, who set up the sanctuary, candles last week, setting up on Palm Sunday and attending to everything. And to the administration staff, look after our finances and communications behind the scenes. For your work, especially these last few weeks, I give thanks. But I got to give one final call out, and that is to honor our children's minister, Allison, who creates the most amazing children's stories you can imagine with her amazing, magnificent Bible blanket fort. I don't know. You had to be there to see it. Last week, she took the kids to Jerusalem. So you got to click on Kidstown and you will see this. She took them to Jerusalem and reported the story from DNN Network. That's Donkey News Network, because she was taking it from the donkey's perspective. You got to see it to believe it. Sort of like faith. Anyway, I put that to you. Over the last few weeks and even just a few days ago on Friday, on Good Friday, I was trying to communicate that we are not alone. That even in the midst of this horrific pandemic, God has not abandoned us. I even communicated that God came to the gates of hell to rescue us. He loves us that much. Today, rather than giving you proofs of the resurrection, rather than a sermon title on why I believe in the resurrection, which I have done in previous years, and I believe is important, I want to spend my time today talking more about how the resurrection will happen to you, and why the resurrection, or what it really means, especially to those of you who are committed to walking with God in Christ Jesus. So let's simply begin with the reading of the appointed text for this year. It's Matthew 28. What an amazing story. What a wild story. There are many takeaways from this. That's why preachers preach year in and year out, seemingly on the same story. And I'm hoping I can come up with something maybe you haven't thought of before. What I want to land on, just a few points. The women, it's Mary and Mary. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. So I call them M&M, the women, okay? The women were directed to tell the others and that they would finally see Jesus in Galilee. Now, I have to tell you, at first glance, I find that odd. I would think that if I was going to be resurrected, and I wanted to make a big statement so that everybody would get it, I would send them to downtown Jerusalem. You know, let's go to the temple, stand outside the gate, and say, he is risen. But that's not the directive. We need to grasp this, is that God, as I said in previous sermons, God sometimes tells us to do things that don't seem quite intuitive. Why would you be going to Galilee to see him? Okay, we can step on that. But this is an important piece. Matthew 28, verses 5 through 7. If you have your Bible there, you can look at it closely, but I'll just tell you if you missed it. It's the angel who appears to them. And the angel says to them, go. And here's what's vital for us to get. And I've seen this in other passages before, but I have to tell you, as I was praying and working on this sermon today, for today, this was new for me. I'd never really picked this up before. I've seen parallels before, so I knew the pattern. But boy, here it is in spades. What was new? You may well know this, and I'm sorry, all you great scholars and people of faith, and I'm a little slower, but this is what I got. It's as they went, they met Jesus. The angel of the Lord comes to them and says, go to the disciples and tell them this, that he is risen, he's not here, etc. And then go to Galilee. Okay, strange message. So what do? They haven't seen Jesus. They've just seen an empty tomb. So that's why they're filled with fear, but they also have some joy. And what is this story? A rational person would say, what do you mean, go to Galilee? A rational person might say, he's just not here. Someone's stolen him. I mean, what's up? But by faith and obedience, they go to tell the disciples. And it is in the doing, it is in the going, they see Jesus. It's there in verse 8. Verse 8 is very important. It's this transition that in the doing, in the action, God honors them. Then and only then do they see Jesus. Verse 9 says, suddenly, and my point is only then, Jesus meets them. They don't understand everything, but in their obedience, the revelation of the resurrection is made known to them. I'm asking whether you see, when I preach and you're all here, I often say, are you with me? Do you get it? I'm looking for a nod. And so I know whether to recalibrate or whatever. I've just made two points here. There is this revelation of information, but they have not had that seal on their heart where they see the risen Jesus until they act. Two parts. This is the mystery of the resurrection. And my contention is you will not see it until you act on it. They were not equipped with theology. They were not equipped with, here are 12 proofs for the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ. They didn't have any of that, and you don't need that either. I think all those apologetics on the issues of, tell me why this is reasonable, and I can actually build cases. We've looked at Lee Strobel. We've looked at all sorts of people over the years who've done a great job of explaining why it's actually reasonable to believe in the resurrection. My contention is those cases, those proofs, convert almost nobody. Those proofs are good for those of us who already have faith. And when I have faith and all of a sudden I have this belief, and then all of a sudden this rationale is put to me, it deepens my faith. But it doesn't make my faith. It might for some. But overall, I believe it is by faith, which is an action, which is a stepping out, where we believe. I believe Matthew is telling us that if we want to believe in the resurrection, we, like those women, have to first act. Then we will see. And the adage has always been, faith first, then understanding. And we live in a world that says, give me understanding, and then I'll have faith. But it is one of the mysteries, one of the most unreasonable parts of our Christian faith. And it's just the way God does it. He wants you to step out in faith. Are you having a hard time with the resurrection? Well, join the rest of us. But as we step out in faith, we experience the resurrection. And that's kind of the second part of the sermon, trying to explain what's the import of all this. Let me give you an example of stepping out in faith and how all of a sudden incredible things happen by the power of the resurrection, by the power of the Spirit of God working. It was a story told to me by a pastor. And he said there was this older woman, not elderly, older woman. He didn't give me her age. This older woman had a real burden for the youth in her church. And she prayed about it. And she said, "Lord, I've got this deep heart for the kids, but I'm not a youth worker. Like, I don't do youth worker. I have no credentials. I've got no experience. I have none of that." And so she prayed about it. And she had this deep conviction that she was supposed to lead the youth program. And so she prayed about it. And so what did she do? She acted on it. She stepped out in faith. And in the doing, this incredible ministry happened. Talking to the pastor, he said 10 years later, he lived in a smaller town. He said, 10 years later, this youth group was the talk of the town, and we learned how to do youth ministry because of her work. It's irrational. All your logical job description proofs don't add up. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, by the power of a resurrected story life, she launched out, she stepped out in faith, and by so doing, in the testimony, she even said, "My faith has grown so much. I've learned so much from the kids." So there was this give and take. This is how the kingdom of God works. And it gives glory to God, not to that woman per se, because she knew she didn't have the skills. We are called to do the same. We are called to do the same as Eminem, the two women at the tomb. I just like to contrast to this life of faith, contrasting the women Eminem at the tomb and how they moved on, or this woman I just told you about. The guards who were at that tomb, they were exactly at the same place. They experienced the rumblings, the earthquakes. That's why they were scared half to death. Angels appearing, I guess that's a reasonable response. They're white as lightning, rolls back the tomb. But those guards are, as they're in the same location as the women, believe nothing. Isn't that interesting? They believe nothing by contrast. And this is an indication that they have not stepped out in faith. They haven't taken this. They haven't done anything with it. There is fear they have, but no joy, certainly no faith. They still think that the chief priests and the elders are the ones with the real power in the world. They don't see because they did not have faith. There's your contrast. And that's why we need to step out and act. We are called to do the same as Mary and Mary. And when that happens, resurrection life gets into you. You don't accept Jesus, although we use that language, accept Jesus, take Jesus on, fair enough. But in a very precise theological way, you don't accept Jesus, you become aware that Jesus has accepted you. And that's where Christianity turns. It's wonderful. I want to reference a great author, a gift to the church. N.T. Wright, you've heard me quote from him before. This is a book called Surprised by Hope. The subtitle of the text of the book is great, though. Rethinking Heaven, the Resurrection, and the Mission of the Church. Surprised by Hope, N.T. Wright. He's an Anglican bishop and scholar. There's another work Simply Christian, Why Christianity Makes Sense. Both of these were published in 08 and 2010. I can't emphasize enough, if you want to learn more about this, and a whole new, and where I'm going to go in this last section of my sermon today comes from Tom Wright. This is a little heavier, but it's really important. Resurrection is not simply about a dead body being raised from the dead. That's noteworthy enough, but the resurrection is our launching pad. That's his language. Our launching pad, something too many have just not understood. So as Jesus was resurrected, so will you be. As he was brought to glory, so will you be brought to glory. As he had work to do, so you have work to do. This is what the church talks about, you see. The church, when the church talks about vocation and calling, what's God's call on your life? You might be a doctor or candlestick maker or whatever, but you may have another calling that God has called you to, a gifting of hospitality or kindness. These are gifts that you are called to exercise. Because there is a resurrection, there is new life for us now. The resurrection is the first act. Jesus' resurrection is the first act or first action. And from there, it's a launching pad, if you will, of a new creation. What does St. Paul say? This is read in our old prayer book from 1 Corinthians 15. St. Paul says this: the resurrection of Jesus, now listen closely, the resurrection of Jesus is the first fruit of what God is planning to do in all of creation, transforming the world, moving from death to life, until the glory of the Lord will fill the earth as the waters cover the sea. Note, he does not say the resurrection means, oh, if you believe in the resurrection, you get to go to heaven. That there is eternal life, yes, but it's so much more than that. It's the first fruits. It's the first sign that God is not only in charge, but he is recreating the entire creation, recreating this fallen world. And it's why we're an Easter people. The resurrection of Jesus is the launching pad, the first act in a grand design that includes you and me. We are living in the in-between time, the age between Easter and the fulfillment of God's promise of complete restoration and new creation. We are not passive spectators. We are not just people who know a great secret. I mean, this is part of the concern that I have, and that the writers, many Christian writers, are saying, that we keep in our hearts this secret I have. Oh, Jesus is risen and I'm a Christian, but I'm going to keep it a secret. You can't keep it a secret. You got to go tell. You got to go witness. You got to do what the women at the tomb did. They proclaimed. They didn't have to give all the proofs for it. They just said, he is risen. He is real. And then we are those agents of Easter. And too many of us, too many people, it's like, oh, I'm a Christian, but I don't need the church. I don't need to be involved. As though you've got two tickets to the big game and you're going to get in at the end of time. Great. I'm happy for you. And it's true. But God is doing this whole recreation. Listen carefully. This is not just about Jesus. Easter is also our launching pad as witnesses of the resurrection. We are Christ's ambassadors, commissioned to tell everyone where the earth really is headed. And I hear people who are saying, even Christians, that the world's going to hell in a handbasket. And did I say that nasty word from the pulpit? Yes, I did. That the world is going there in a handbasket. It's not. COVID notwithstanding, the world will only get better as the church and as Christians, as we proclaim this gospel, as God gets a hold of us, gets into us, and starts transforming us, and we start transforming other people. And will it be difficult? Sure. I won't be too much longer, but this is coming to me. It's Bishop Tutu. When he was doing all his work with apartheid, he was saying, this is hard. We're making no headway. This is tough. But he knew, because he was a resurrected person, he was a part of the Christian community, he knew the truth. And he said, when I read the end of the book, the Bible, we win. Like, God is bringing this. This will come to be where all are equal. Sooner or later, it will happen. You see, that's resurrection faith. Even in the midst of difficulty. And that's what you need to have. That's what we need to have. And that's why this resurrection faith is so important. Or as St. Paul says in Colossians 3, since you have been raised with Christ, set your mind on things above, because your life is now hidden in Christ. See, I have this intimate place because of this resurrection, this hope that I walk with Christ. I don't wear it on my sleeve all the time. It's a mystery, but it is the source of my actions, and I pray it's the source of your actions if you call yourselves Christian. So let me wrap up. In the midst of these COVID days, I don't really understand this any more than you. But be clear, God has not willed this as some judgment. I do not see that. There may be some theologian who thinks that, some TV evangelist who has said it, and I can't disagree more. God has not visited COVID-19 on us. I think he weeps in the midst of all of this. But we are called in the midst of this difficulty to be a resurrection people, an Easter people, to a broken world. And when people are not kind to you, for you to be kind, to phone your neighbor, to write the letter, enjoy your children more than ever, be a positive force for God. Henri Nouwen writes, our society is not a community radiant with love of Christ, but a dangerous network of domination and manipulation in which we can easily get entangled and lose our souls. We need to recognize our role in the resurrection, that if we act in faith, that will be our launching pad. Resurrection is not just about you getting into heaven, it is about heaven getting into you. It is about a whole new world order, a whole new way of thinking about living in the here and the now. I appreciate that it is hard to be an agent for change when we're all locked in our rooms. But maybe this resurrection time is a time for us to reevaluate our lives, to examine how it is that we spend our time. Maybe we need to be doing more justice work, community work, than watching TV. Or maybe we need to examine what it is that we truly worship. So when this pandemic is over, and trust me, it will be over, we whose lives are hidden with Christ, we who are the resurrection community, will launch out from our homes, breaking into a world with resurrection faith and good news. Like the women at the tomb that first Easter morning, I encourage you to step out in faith and you will see Jesus, the resurrected Lord. God bless you. Amen.
Inside the lie of inward shame.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave.
These prayers for Easter Sunday. Be mindful as I offer these prayers of those who struggle with isolation, with deep illnesses, with anxiety, with stress in their families, as people are trying to make sense of these things. And so I offer this intercession. We pray that our risen Savior may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection. We pray to the Lord, hear us, Lord of glory. Pray that isolated and persecuted churches may find fresh strength in the Easter gospel. We pray to thee, Lord, hear us, Lord of glory. That God may grant us humility to be subject to one another in Christian love. We pray to the Lord, hear us, Lord of glory. And that he may provide for those who lack food and work, shelter. We pray to the Lord, hear us, Lord of glory. And by your power, Almighty God, wars and famine may cease, and epidemics and pandemics through all the earth. We pray to thee, Lord, hear us, Lord of glory. And that God may reveal the light of his presence to the sick, to the weak, and to the dying, that they may be comforted and strengthened. We pray to the Lord. So hear us, Lord of glory. And finally, that God may send the fire of the Holy Spirit upon his people, that we may bear faithful witness to his resurrection. We pray to the Lord, hear us, Lord of glory. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And on this Easter Sunday, may God bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and grant you peace and grace now and forevermore. Amen.